My name is Lisa, and I'm a librarian over at West Harrison Library, and I have here with me...
I'm Giovanna, and I am a librarian at the Harrison Public Library.
So today we have a selection of books that we've chosen that we have especially enjoyed, and we'd like to share them with you. So I'm going to begin. I read quite a few of the psychological thrillers recently. I've read Gone Girl, I've read Girl Before, Girl on the Train, Woman in the Window, and this book by far is my favorite. It is Unraveling Oliver by Liz Nugent. And the reason I like it so much is the writing is very compelling and very dark. Now, I just want to read you the first sentence of the book. It starts out by saying, I expected more of a reaction the first time I hit her. So that starts out and grabs you right away. It's one of the best first lines that I've come across in a really long time in a book. As to the main characters, Oliver Ryan is the main character, and he's a beloved children's author with a very dark past. And through the voices of the characters, the friends and family who know Oliver, we slowly get a clear picture of the unraveling of Oliver, who he is and what made him that way. So I won't go into too much about it because I don't want to reveal all the good stuff, but I'll just tell you that with each passing chapter, the tension slowly builds until we discover all of Oliver's secrets. Mm. Now, this book was named Crime Novel of the Year by the Irish Book Awards. It's one of those books that was kind of under the radar. Came out last year. It didn't get a lot of hype and book buzz, but it is truly a really good read. Really enjoyed it. Couldn't put it down. Okay. That's okay. For me. Giovanna?
So my first book is Little Fires Everywhere by Celeste Ng, and it's received rave reviews from all around. It was winner of Goodreads Reader's Choice Award 2017 Fiction, Amazon's Best Novel of 2017, Instant New York Times Bestseller. So obviously sometimes the reviews don't meet up with the actual quality of the book, but I would say that it deserves every single award that it received. If you like books by Jodi Picoult or Paula Hawkins, who wrote Girl on the Train, then this would be a read for you as well. And it takes place in a town in Shaker Heights in the suburbs of Cleveland. And we have a family that's lived there for years, the Richardsons, and then we have the sort of outcasts who visit the town. We have Mia Warren and her daughter Pearl. And with this new combination of characters, we have an intertwined story and issues that deal with motherhood, with identity. There are a lot of secrets in this book. And as the title suggests, little fires everywhere. There literally mm-hmm. are little fires, literally, at the end of the story, which actually the book begins with the end, which mm-hmm. is always a good way to hook the reader mm-hmm. in. And then you learn a little bit more about what has transpired and also the secrets that mainly the outcasts are keeping. I won't go into too much of the plot. There is an issue with the family that wants to adopt a Chinese American woman. And this sets off the outcast, Mia Warren, and her daughter, Pearl, against the Richardson family, mainly the matriarch, Elena Richardson. And it just unravels, to use the term mm-hmm. from your book, a whole chain of events. It's a quick read, and if you like
Unraveling Oliver,
mm-hmm. and Girl on the Train, suspense but contemporary literature, then you'll enjoy this mm-hmm. one.
That sounds interesting.
Yeah, it was a keeper.
Okay, great. Okay, so I'll do the next one. My next choice. So I'm gonna start out by asking you guys a question. Can you imagine what it would feel like to discover that one of your relatives was a Nazi war criminal? Well, that's what happened to 38-year-old Jennifer Tiga, a German-born biracial woman. In her memoir, My Grandfather Would Have Shot Me, by Jennifer Tiga, Jennifer tells the story of how one day she's perusing the shelves at her local library in Hamburg, Germany. She comes across this book which links her past to that of a man named Amon Gert. Now, Amon Gert was a Nazi commandant at the Plaszow concentration camp in Krakow, Poland. He was known as the Butcher of Plaszow. Okay? He was responsible for the deaths of tens of thousands of Germans and Poles during the Holocaust. So Jennifer discovers that this man is her maternal grandfather. Okay, really shocking news for her. So this news, this discovery sends her into a tizzy. She goes into a deep depression, but she also, as a result, sets out on a journey, and she actually travels from her home in Germany to Krakow, Poland, and she goes to visit the remains of the concentration camp, as well as going to visit her, as well as to visit Amon Gert's home where he lived near the concentration camp. She's doing this in an effort to search for her own self-identity. You know, who is she? She's wondering. Once you discover something shocking like this, it makes you wonder about yourself and who you really are. So I chose this book because it sheds a different perspective on the Holocaust, that and which is namely that of the parents and the children and the grandchildren of these Nazi war criminals. You know, how did these families cope with knowing that their relatives had committed such atrocities? What did they do? How did they deal with this? Did they deny it? Did they minimize it? Excuse it? Should they feel guilty? How guilty should they feel over this? So this book examines these questions. I found it very readable, very thought-provoking. We use this book in our book group at a different library, actually, and it provided a lot of just really good discussion. So I would encourage everyone to pick it up and read it.
And we're also reading this book for our April Book of the Month for our global reading group, and that will be at the Jewish Community Center in Harrison on April 23rd at 7:30. Everyone is welcome to come. Even if you haven't finished the book, you're still welcome to join us.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so my next book, An American Marriage by Tayari Jones, and it's an Oprah Winfrey Book Club book. It's recently published February of this year, and it's also received much acclaim. I was able to finish it in about two nights.
Wow.
With an uninterrupted other reading time. Because once I started, you really want to know what happens to the characters. We have a love triangle in the book. It doesn't start off that way necessarily. We have Celestial and Roy, who are newly married, 18 months. And Andre is best friend to both of them. Actually, he was the best man at their wedding. And an unfortunate event happens where Roy is unjustly accused of criminal activity and is incarcerated for 12 years, which leaves Celeste still by his side as his wife. He's incarcerated in Atlanta. They live in Louisiana. So there's a much dynamics happening within the story. It's told, the first portion is in epistolary through letters, which is actually really interesting to get a sense of what's happening with the characters, what they're feeling. It's interesting also because due to this incarceration, Roy encounters someone who's important to his life and didn't think he'd ever meet. So there's always a silver lining in the story. There's very strong character development, and you get the three viewpoints, which really helps you to really feel for each of these characters. No one is wrong in how they feel and how they act per se, but it's just this unfortunate circumstance where they really, it's beyond their control. So when I was able to hear the author talk about the book, she mentioned how it took her 6 years to write the book, that she had written it completely start to finish and then wasn't satisfied with it. She did a good amount of research on incarcerated Black men, and she knew she wanted to tell that type of story with that situation. She couldn't get the inspiration, and she discusses how she was in a mall in Atlanta, and she was listening to a couple have an exchange, and that's when she got the idea to have one character, the husband, incarcerated, and the wife then free and left to sort of deal with her life and her identity as well. So you have themes of injustice, betrayal, loyalty as well, which are all topics that people can relate to. And I think it would have been successful even if it hadn't been an Oprah Winfrey book club choice, simply because it's very gripping. The writing is wonderful. The storytelling is excellent. And at the end, you just feel somewhat exhausted. I guess maybe that's a good sign of a book. I don't know. But just because, you know, by the end, there's some closure, but there's still a lot of mending that has to happen. So that's my second book.
Okay, that sounds good. Okay, so back to me. I'm gonna going to suggest my last book. This is called Mrs. Fletcher by Tom Perrotta. It came out August of last year. Mrs. Fletcher is a contemporary story, and it's about a 40-something-year-old divorced woman who sets out to explore her own sexuality through the use of today's social media. And what I mean by that is she goes and visits pornography sites, okay? So hear me out on this. Eve Fletcher, the main character, she is a divorced mother whose only son, Brendan, a somewhat self-absorbed party boy, is heading off to college. And while Eve is a professional woman, she has a very satisfying career. She is an executive director of a local senior citizen center. She has always built her life around her son. And so now her son is leaving to begin his own adventure. And the question is, what will she do with the rest of her life, with her, you know, with her spare time? What will she do? So she starts out by taking a night class at a local community college. And that's all well and good. She meets some friends, she likes the topic, she's enjoying the class, but even so, Eve is lonely. So she begins seeking solace in what is called MILF pornography. Okay, MILF, it's an acronym. I'm not going to spell it out for you, but I think, I think people could kind of figure it out. If you can't, you can go and Google it. But so Eve resorts to doing this, and the story gets a little racy here, but it's still within a tasteful parameters there. Meanwhile, her son Brendan, away at school, is having difficulties of his own. He's not doing well in his classes, and he's committed a few social faux pas, which have like rendered him kind of on the outside of things. So the story itself, it has a lot of humor to it. There's a lot of anecdotes about Eve's job at the senior center and the antics that go on there. There's also funny dating scenarios. Topics that are covered are the empty nest syndrome, the trials and tribulations of middle-aged dating, actually gender issues as well. So those are all explored in the story. It's a fun story. It's a page turner. It gets a little racy at times, but that just makes it all the more fun. Yeah. I read it in like 2 days. It's a really quick read. And for those looking for something light, contemporary and fun. I think you might like it.
And you had mentioned that it's tastefully done?
It's tastefully done. It's on the racy side, but I think it's less racy than some of the others, like those 50 Shades.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's a
little,
more tame than that.
Okay. I might give it a shot. Based on your
review.
So this is our last book we'll be discussing. Did you read this one, Chilberry Ladies Choir?
A long time ago.
It's actually an invented town called Chilberry, which is near Kent. And it's based on the author's grandmother's experience, who lived during that time in another little village similar to Chilberry. She was 20 years old. And then because all the men were gone, this time of war, everyone felt like today might be their last day. So the morals sort of shifted a little. This is not a racy book by any means. Maybe if you lived in the 1940s, it would be considered racy. But you have a lot of activity. You have baby swapping, you have blackmail, you have double agents, secrets, villains, and heroes, and you have a nice mixture. And it's a calm read, but not necessarily, there is some tragedy in it as well, which I think is what makes it such an interesting book. It's told in epistolary as well. We have letters and we have journals, journal entries. Again, you really get to know your characters and what's going through their heads and, you know, why they're making certain decisions, even though they're not the wisest decisions to make. But the story is really about empowering women too, because as the title suggests, it's an all-women's choir, but that's basically because there are no men left in the town. But because of that, they sort of rise to the occasion and take on more responsibility, and they also do things that maybe they wouldn't have done in the past, and they stand up for themselves. And I guess it's also a story about identity, and you have a whole range of characters, and they're all people that you know someone just like that person, you know, the character that's always the naysayer, the one that's, you know, not really paying attention to things, the one that's very strict and regimented, and then the carefree, you know, live and let live type. So it really covers the whole range of personalities in this one small village. And I think by the end of the book, it's a happy ending, so to speak. There is a sequel planned for it as well, I found out, because there were a few loose ends in the story. But if you like books like Lilac Girls and Kristen Hannah's Nightingale, which a few people compared it to that, even though the stories are vastly different, then I think you'll enjoy the Chilberry Ladies Choir. And that's it.
Okay, that sounds good.
All right.
Okay, so thank you for tuning in.